Alan Moore is a British author who isn't afraid to be controversial. He's very creative in his approach to storytelling, and I really like these little clips that we're gonna I'm gonna have you watch that explore several things. First of all, he in his very dramatic way jumps into the idea that literacy and the ability to write was viewed as magical in the ancient world, and you study ancient cultures, people that could write had unbelievable power and could create so much of the structure of people's beliefs and their view of life and worldview and so on. So it's a very fun little video clip where he explores that out. I really like the ending of it, where he talks about even how one of the worst things that could happen to a person would be that some kind of cynical commentary, satire about a person could kind of follow them to the grave. So you'll want to watch that entire clip. The second clip explores the complexity of character development, and of course Moore pushes that maybe further than some other writers would do it, but the idea that, you know, when you're talking about a villain or an antagonist protagonist kind of complexity, that Moore pushes some of those boundaries. At the very end, I like this little clip. He's talking at a library and just talking about the idea of success and what it means to be a writer. And this also would apply, obviously, to artists. But that making a living as a artist isn't always necessarily the benchmark of being a successful artist. So it's just a nice reminder. So enjoy.
There is some confusion as to what magic actually is. I think that this can be cleared up if you just look at the very earliest descriptions of magic. Magic, in its earliest form, is often referred to as the art. I believe that this is completely literal. I believe that magic is art, and that art, whether that be writing, music, sculpture, or any other form, is literally magic. Art is, like magic, the science of manipulating symbols, words or images, to achieve changes in consciousness. The very language of magic seems to be talking as much about writing or art as it is about supernatural events. A grimoire, for example, the Book of Spells, is simply a fancy way of saying grammar. Indeed, to cast a spell is simply to spell, to manipulate words, to change people's consciousness. And I believe that this is why an artist or writer is the closest thing in the contemporary world that you are likely to see to a shaman. I believe that all culture must have arisen from cult. Originally, all of the facets of our culture, whether they be in the arts or the sciences, were the province of the shaman. The fact that in present times this magical power has degenerated to the level of cheap entertainment and manipulation is, I think, a tragedy. At the moment, the people who are using shamanism and magic to shape our culture are advertisers. Rather than trying to wake people up, their shamanism is used as an opiate to tranquilize people, to make people more manipulable. Their magic box of television, and by their magic words, their jingles, can cause everybody in the country to be thinking the same words and have the same banal thoughts all at exactly the same moment. In all of magic, there is an incredibly large linguistic component. The bardic tradition of magic would place a bard as being much higher and more fearsome than a magician. A magician might curse you. That might make your hens lay funny, or you might have a child born with a club foot. If a bard were to place not a curse upon you, but a satire, then that could destroy you. If it was a clever satire, it might not just destroy you in the eyes of your associates. It would destroy you in the eyes of your family. It would destroy you in your own eyes. And if it was a finely worded and clever satire that might survive and be remembered for decades, even centuries, then years after you were dead, people still might be reading it and laughing at you and your wretchedness and your absurdity. Writers and people who had command of words were respected and feared as people who manipulated magic. In latter times, I think that artists and writers have allowed themselves to be sold down the river. They have accepted the prevailing belief that art and writing are merely forms of entertainment. They're not seen as transformative forces that can change a human being, that can change a society. They are seen as simple entertainment, things with which we can fill 20 minutes, half an hour, while we're waiting to die. It is not the job of artists to give the audience what the audience want. If the audience knew what they needed, then they wouldn't be the audience. They would be the artists. It is the job of artists to give the audience what they need.
Alan Moore is the man behind the mask worn by computer hackers and Occupy protesters the world over. But he's no typical insurgent, rather a graphic novelist. It was he who dreamt up the anarchist superhero with the ghostly bearded mask, whose face has now become perhaps the symbol for subversion. Alan Moore has in the past championed graphic novels, book-length comics, for their effect on politics and culture. Why is he now becoming disillusioned? Welcome to Hard Talk.
A pleasure to be here, Tim.
I described you as a writer of graphic novels, but you've said in the past that the term comics will do just as well. But these aren't comics like most people might think of them.
That's true. I mean, I suppose that in the 1980s, there were a few comic books that were actually handling more adult material, not necessarily in terms of sex or violence, but actually more intelligent ideas. And there were only a few of them, but the comics industry tended to seize upon them and come up with this catch-all phrase of graphic novels that, with the best will in the world, a load of collected Spider-Man stories is not a novel.
No, but some of the work that you have put out does sit more happily in terms of novel rather than comic. I mean, Time magazine put one of your novels, Watchmen, on its list of 100 greatest ever novels. I'm wondering whether you were proud to be made part of the canon or whether the anti-establishment bit of you was a bit cross about that.
Well, I wasn't very sure about that Time magazine poll because I believe that for a few weeks Watchmen was not only on the 100 best list, but for a few weeks it was at the top of it. I think it ended up in the top five. I can easily think of 100 great American novels that probably would have deserved to be there rather than me. But no, it was a nice thing that people thought so well of the book.
And Watchmen themselves, I mean, this is a bunch of superheroes or heroes who are not in your normal superhero mold. They're raddled, they're slightly degenerate, they're damaged individuals, aren't they? You're trying to subvert the genre.
Well, it was more a case of when we actually did Watchmen, I was trying to think what these fairly ridiculous characters would be like if they were actually existing in a real world. I mean, in the real world, we have lots of traumatized children, but very few of them go on to become bat-themed vigilantes. So I was trying to imply that if you were going to put on a costume and fight crime, it would probably be for all sorts of complex and probably unpleasant reasons.
And some of them meet fates that are sort of pathetic, aren't they? I mean, the one who gets his cape caught in the revolving door of a bank and ends up being shot by one of the armed robbers that he's trying to protect the customers against. Yeah. Again, it's a matter of subversion, isn't it?
Well, yes, and also, I mean, we took the standard Batman image, the person who is compulsively dedicated to eradicating crime. And thinking about that in the real world, it seems that such a person would probably be a lonely, paranoid vigilante. He'd probably have terrible hygiene habits, no friends. This seemed to be a more feasible reality rather than living in a mansion and having a sumptuous bat cave.
When we talk about reality, one of your most celebrated characters has been appropriated by Occupy protesters, by computer hackers across the world. This is the image from your book V for Vendetta back in the 1980s. This is a superhero who's an anarchist terrorist trying to fight the forces of fascism and repression. Is this character a hero for you?
Well, we called the very first episode The Villain because I thought that there was an ambiguity there that I wanted to preserve. One of the reasons that we decided to use the character was because in Britain we have got quite a tradition of making heroes out of criminals or people who in other centuries might have been regarded as terrorists. So I was deciding to play with that, to take somebody who, in context of the society in which he's existing, would be seen as a villain or a terrorist.
But to you, seen as what? Because he does employ terrorist tactics.
Yes, he does. He seems to me to be a symbol of anarchy, whereas the other characters in the book, the totalitarian state, they are more symbols of fascism, which I tended to see as being the two poles of
politics.
But
you have described yourself as an anarchist.
Yes.
So in that case, presumably, you veer more towards his view of life.
I certainly
life.
Do.
But I'm talking about his tactics. I mean,
his tactics.
Clearly you wouldn't say that people should go out and blow up the Houses of Parliament or the Royal Courts of Justice,
of
as
not.
He does.
Of course not.
But he uses violence for a purpose. Is that something that
that
you
is something which
with?
I don't sympathise with. In fact, in the actual book, I haven't seen the film, but I believe that this wasn't really expanded upon in the film. But in the book, we took a great deal of trouble to actually examine the fact that, all right, this guy is the titular hero of the story. Is it all right for him to kill people just because he's the hero? And I think in book three, it's finally decided that no, it isn't. That killing people is always wrong. And at that point, the initial hero, V, stands down and lets a non-violent person take over the role. So it was an exploration of ideas.
You